Welcome to Tradier is the Trader's Edge. If I seem a little crabby today, it's because I've been having computer problems. It's literally taking me about 15 minutes to get this podcast started. I apologize to anyone who's had to wait. Actually, we're actually reasonably on time.
We're on time. You're just not as smiley as usual because I pick on you all the time, man, behind your back as well as to your face. That you and I are the same age. I think you're 2 weeks older, 2 weeks younger. I don't remember what. And you are 150 when it comes to this tech.
I know. I need someone. But my wife is pretty good at it. So yeah. She's in there, but she hates being on camera. Like, so she just runs out like when she thinks she's about to start. So, but anyway, what are your thoughts? A week ago, we did this show. Jerome Powell basically just said, yeah, GDP is going higher. Yeah, inflation is going higher. Yeah, I'm going to ease anyway. That to me still seems to be the biggest story, no?
Yeah, it is. And you know what's interesting? So in an hour and a half, 2 hours, somewhere in that range, Fed Governor Christopher Waller is speaking at the Economic Club of New York. Now, he is, in my view, the head of the What's the Rush contingent at the FOMC. Okay. So if he's pivoted, I mean, we're going. We already been going, right? We had the highest close to the Russell today. And yeah, we're closed, right? Yeah, we're closed. Highest close for the Russell in the future side in 2 years, since March 28th of 2022.
But still a long way from all-time
highs. 13.5% from its all-time high. 13.5%, so a ways to go. But this is definitely positive, and we have the perfect guy for this.
We do, which is funny because, and I, again, I'll say this every week, and I don't mind saying it. You guys can think Bobby and I are full shit, and you can actually, you know, probably be right in some ways. But you cannot deny that we get outstanding guests. And today we have an old friend and an excellent technician and a wealth of knowledge. And it is Ryan Detrick, head market strategist at Carson Financial, Carson Capital. Do you know what it's called? Anyway, let's bring him in.
That is the little surprise for Ryan, because I affectionately and admirably call him Mr. Brightside, because in all of the 3.5-4 years I've known you, you've always had this this view. Things happen, and inevitably you can go to Ryan's Twitter and Ryan will go, yeah, things look bad right now, but in 18 of the last 20 times this happened, and so on. And so my question is, and I say this again, admirably and affectionately, you always seem to have the bright side of things regardless of what's happening. Is that because you work in the sort of buy and hold investment space? Is it because stocks basically always go up for the most part? What's the reason for that approach?
Well, guys, thanks for having me back. Jim, I'm glad you figured out the technology there. And
I'm going to kill somebody, Ron, I swear to God.
Take a breath. I'll talk for a little bit. Take a breath. Yeah, so actually, Carson Group's name of the company. Carson Group is an RIA based in Omaha. I'm in Cincinnati, Ohio, where I live. But that's a great point because, yes, I'm a chief market strategist at a $34 billion RIA. So are we ever going to truly say, get out of everything, buy gold, hide under the bed? No, probably not, right? We're investing people's money, usually for several decades. So we are fully aware of that. Now, you know, to be clear, I mean, we have been overweight equities. I came on with you guys last year. I was probably one of the few people that said, you know, things might be okay here. And sure enough, they were. We get into all that.
You were right.
We can get into all that stuff. But, you know, yes, markets do tend to go higher. But I'm a firm believer that these cycles last a while. By no means am I like a day trader or a weekly trader. Let's be very clear. More of a, you know, tactical hold for 3-9 months or so, or at least views for 3 to 9 months is probably a better word to use there. So yes, but we know these cycles last a while. And fortunately, I think we're still in a cycle that's going to last a good while. And that's kind of how I see it. But I mean, we manage a lot of models. Believe me, some of them are more short-term tactical. We can do overweights and underweights. We've got constraints. Don't want to get too in the weeds here. We do have constraints. But we're not really allowed to go like net short or something like that, because again, we're an RIA managing for people's money or retirement in a lot of cases. But still, sometimes that's maybe better, right? You look at what happened last year. Maybe it was better if you had some constraints and told you had to have a little equity risk in there.
In my And part of the reason I know your Twitter so well, and it's at Ryan Detrick, last name is D-E-T-R-I-C-K. Yep. Part of the reason I know your ex so well is because obviously Jimmy and I are both active. We'll call ourselves active investors. Mm-hmm. My average hold time in the main work that I do is 26 days. Yeah. But obviously we're buy and hold people too. We have our own investment portfolios. And whenever I start to worry about that, or whenever I'm helping a friend or a family member with their longer term stuff, and I'm getting stressed out because of what's happening in the short term stuff, I go to your Twitter. And inevitably I get worried if you haven't posted something positive, something.
So,
it looks bad right now. Go ahead, Jimmy.
Cause I just figured something out. Like, Ryan, where are you from?
Originally, I'm from Springfield, Ohio, went to Xavier University in Cincinnati. So I live in Southwestern Ohio.
Yeah, I'm a basketball guy, so I know Xavier quite well.
There you go.
Okay, so I've just put my finger on the pulse of something, Bobby. Tell me, it's like you've never, like, you have weren't in the trading pits of Chicago for 35 years like Bobby and I have, which made us cranky old men who have a rough
100%.
Ass. Were you? But so my, like, I don't, when I text you, I tweeted that today. My goal is to drag you down into my crabbiness and get you to swear. I don't have high hopes for achieving that goal, but you know, a guy can dream, right?
Sure. Oh, you can dream. Yeah, no, that's true. I mean, I did trade options for about 11 years. I guess up until maybe 2013 or so at a small options shop here in Cincinnati. But again, no, I wasn't in the pits, you know, doing those types of things. That's where I got more of my analytical background. But yeah, I mean, I will. You want me to say the F word? Am I allowed to say the F word?
Yeah, absolutely.
Fuck yeah.
Okay. The Fed. That's my F word. That's about as bad as I get, guys. That's my joke. I know. It's a terrible joke. I know. The other joke I use is Fibonacci or fundamentals, depending on the crowd. You know, I can use the F word depending on the crowd. A lot of F words out there. So, yeah.
Can we talk? You today tweeted about small caps, which I think is fascinating. Yeah. Bobby brought it up as well, too, before. So I am long small caps. And yeah, I was perhaps long small caps for the wrong reasons, because I got into the trade, you know, maybe 6 months ago, and I thought it was going to be a massive catch up, and I thought it was going to be about lower rates. Rates haven't gone lower, and I'm still doing okay. So I don't mind being right for the wrong reasons, but I'd just rather be right for the right reasons. What am I missing in the trade?
Well, you're right. I mean, listen, we know the last 2 months last year, let's talk about Russell 2 for a second, was up 24%. That's like, if you look at the top 10 best 2 months ever for the Russell 2, I believe that was the second or third best.
When you say the Russell 2, you mean the Russell 2000?
Russell 2000, yeah, sorry. Russell 2000 was up over 24% the last 2 months last year. And why was that? Well, yes, that's when the Fed started hinting at the pivot, right? The pivot, maybe there's going to be some cuts. We thought there'd be some cuts. Then obviously the economy's gotten better. They push back on it. But just think about this here for a second, guys. If you look at all that best 10 two-month periods ever, which again, this was like the third at the end of last year, a year later, the Russell 2000 has been higher 9 times, up 27% on average. So that blast of strength we saw last year, to me, was a sign, and we can, you know, get into some of the whys, but what happened, we saw it. Now we've consolidated here the first half of this year. What's the Russell 2 up, or 2000 up? 3-4% for the year, 5% after today. We know, you know, you're looking at double digits for large caps and things like that. We're optimistic that when all is said and done, small caps have a significantly larger gain on the year than the S&P 500. And honestly, mid-caps have been our favorite area. We've been overweight mid-cap. Nobody talks about it. It's like the Jan Brady, right? No one talks about mid-caps, but they're quietly.
It's always Marsha.
Here. Yeah. What was that?
It's always Marsha.
Yeah, exactly. But then to answer your question, yeah, there's some of that potential pivot, but I'll tell you, we like small and mid because we don't see a recession. We see stronger earnings. Look at earnings expectations for 2025, and I get it. These expectations, they can change, yes. But they're much, much higher for revenue and for earnings on small and mid caps next year in 2025. We're still thinking with all this strong, we can get in all these weeds on this stuff, but the strong productivity we are seeing in our economy. Listen, in the mid to late 90s, what happened? Every year, GDP came in a little bit hotter than expected in the mid to late 90s. We saw strong productivity for the first time in a long time. Now, what's happening? We're seeing, again, stronger productivity with higher GDP. Remember last decade? I know we do, right? The GDP would always be up here, by end of the year, be lower. because productivity was lower. So we think productivity is the key to this whole thing. That stronger economy with the fact that there's better earnings growth, revenue from small and mid, which we think could actually be better than expected, again, with the stronger productivity. Oh, and then the cherry on top is it is what it is. You know, another F word, fundamentals and valuations, right? Valuations on small and mid are historically cheap relative to large. So you add, you smush all that together. It's a trade that we've liked for a while. We've been overweight small and mid since really probably about the third quarter of last year. Been painful at times, but mids have obviously worked pretty well, and small, we think, is going to catch up to it.
So, by the way, Russell up 4.6% as of today. Just so you know. So right in where you right in where you said. So, is there any way to get people to understand that something like the Russell still matters? I was talking to somebody recently, and I'll just use the Russell, but you can use whatever you want. As a small cap sort of representative. I was talking to somebody the other day and I mentioned something about the Dow and they're like, Dow doesn't even matter anymore. Nobody looks at it. Do some of these indices not matter given the strength of A, tech, and B, where the productivity is coming from, which is tech?
Yeah. Well, I hope they keep saying that. Because I'll tell you that contrarian in me thinks they're going to change their tune eventually. We know people chase performance, right? So to hear that, you know, there was a chart running around on Twitter, and I retweeted it actually today. But just looking at active managers, they are wildly underusing small cap funds. Not surprising. It's just not a lot of love and honestly not a great performance there. But that contrarian, right? If everybody's thinking alike, somebody isn't thinking. General Patton, that's my take there. That'll change, Bob, I think, over time if we continue to see the outperformance that we think is very likely and possible here.
So I have a quick question. And I know this is not a type of trade that you would put on. But if you were in our shoes, would you see a short the Magnificent Seven, long the Russells as a value trade?
Yeah, I short answer is yes. I mean, yeah, I know what it was, the Mag 7. Now there's four of them. We've kicked some of them out. But again, you know, it's just incredible the run those stocks have had. We all know that it's a stretch rubber band. There's a lot of earnings, a lot of great things happening. But, you know, I think there's a lot of, I mean, what's Apple lost in market cap? Like $500 billion? Like market didn't seem to care, but maybe some of that's going, some of that's going to the other areas. I would be clear, we like small and mid, but we also in the models we run for our more than almost 400 Carson partners, those are our advisors, all around the country. You know, we've got an overweight again to industrials and financials. We added industrials financials just a couple weeks ago, thinking what we just said there, maybe tech comes back to earth a little bit. I mean, it has to crash, I'll be very clear, but some of those other areas, again, that should do better if the economy does a little bit better, which has been playing out pretty darn well lately, that's kind of where we see things.
I want to throw a little disclaimer in here, if I could, real quick, that if, you know, we're going to ask Ryan questions on this show that is not representative of something he's telling you to do. I want to throw that out there because I could say something like NVIDIA is down two consecutive sessions now. And, you know, what do you think of NVIDIA versus Micron? Ryan is not going to say, I think everybody should buy Micron and sell NVIDIA. Okay. So I want to throw that out there. Having said that, all right, do you see any similarities? There are people that are still trying to break even on Oracle from 2000. Okay. And the three of us are old enough to remember this, right? Mm-hmm. So, the type of move we see in NVIDIA reminded my business partner and Jimmy and mine's friend, Mike Arnold, of Oracle, because what he said was Oracle was...
You mean Cisco, right?
I do mean Cisco. I'm sorry. Yeah. I do mean Cisco. Thank you, Jimmy.
Okay.
Cisco, where he's like, you know, everything's going to the internet. Everybody needs routers. Sure. Cisco makes the routers, right? And right now it's everything's going AI. NVIDIA makes the AI chips. Everybody needs NVIDIA. You see any similarities there at all?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think so. I mean, there's a lot of optimism, a lot of excitement. Everyone knew the internet would be big back then. We didn't know how big. We didn't know where it all go. And you know, it got a little frothy. Now, one of the things that, you know, if you look at like forward S&P 500 earnings on NVIDIA and some of the other Mag 7, I mean, they're pricey, but they're not the 300-400 that we were seeing on a lot of those big tech stocks. I don't know where Cisco was exactly in the late 90s, but there's some similarities there. And I will say this, you mentioned Cisco. When I got the bug at Xavier University in Cincinnati, it was like in 99, one of the very first stocks I ever bought was like Cisco, right? And it went up a whole bunch, like we know, and then it crashed and I lost my, you know what, and I was hooked ever since then.
No, we don't know what. You lost your what?
Lost my money.
Oh, okay. Fair enough. Nice try.
Lost my butt. Nice there you go. Lost my money. But it wasn't my money. It was my dad's money. He gave me some play money, you know. But anyway, you live and learn. But anyway, it's kind of funny here in Cisco. But yeah, I mean, there are some. But I mean, again, you know, I guess what comforts us a little bit, and you guys probably talk about these things. I mean, a lot of these tech companies are making a lot of money. And Amazon, I mean, what do they even do anymore? I mean, they do everything, right? You literally can get like your drugs mailed to you from Amazon now, right? Everything's in the cloud. I mean, we can go on the list on and on. So it's not like these companies are just one trick ponies by any means. Now, the other thing though is, you know, are they too big? Are they too much? I mean, believe me, I probably went with you a year ago when we did this. I pushed against the idea that only 7 stocks are going higher. We thought there were more stocks going higher just on Thursday. So what is today? Today's Wednesday or Thursday, guys? Today's Wednesday, right? Wednesday.
Yeah.
Spring break's like next week and holiday. I don't even know what day it is. But I know this much. Last Thursday, 118 stocks in the S&P 500 made a 52-week high, all right? That's the most we've seen in 3 years. That is breadth that we've been hinting at seeing, and that's a positive. And Bob, you pointed out, like, you know, we're at the Russell 2 futures, highest they've been in a long time. So yep, there is a lot more participation, which is fine. But, you know, those stocks do, I wouldn't say worry me is a strong way to put it, but we've been neutral technology for a while now. Again, overweight industrials, financials, energy for a little bit. We're actually overweight communication services too. That's not nearly the size of technology when you look at the S&P 500. So it's a group that I wouldn't ever want to say underweight that area, because if you're wrong on tech, you can miss a lot, but we're comfortable being even weight here.
Bobby, can I ask a quick question? So Bobby and I were talking about in the beginning before you came on. Yeah. A week ago, Wednesday was an odd day. Chairman came out, GDP is going higher, inflation's going higher, and yeah, we're going to ease anyway. The moment I saw those disjointed comments, I bought gold. And I like the trade. I'm not kidding myself, but you mentioned a bunch of areas, but to me, I have a decent amount of money committed to what I consider no confidence votes in stewardship of our fiat currency. That means Bitcoin, gold, silver, platinum, copper, stocks. Stocks are, you know, not as high on the list as some of those things.
Right.
But I think stocks are a good place to be. But anyway, do you look at those sectors, gold, miners, anything like that, and you think that our current condition warrants that?
Yeah, well, so in the tactical models that we run, Carson Group, we have had about a 3% position in gold, honestly, since a year ago. A year ago, we added that, and obviously, it's been a little frustrating. I looked at it like, an alternative to fixed income, not so much against stocks, but an alternative to fixed income. Fixed income bonds haven't done very well, last I checked. So, yeah, gold is an area that, again, we're optimistic. We think things are going to be okay, but that's at the disaster hedge, if you want to call it that. It's a little strong, because I look at gold from, you know, 2003 to 2007, and gold and stocks went up just fine together, right? And then from 2009 to 2011, gold and stocks went up just fine together. So again, it doesn't mean they can't go together, but again, yeah, we look at gold and we do have a little bit of a sliver in our tactical models, and I think of it more against bonds, which we were in the camp, our team was in the camp, we didn't expect 5 or 6 cuts. I think people say maybe say 7 cuts this time, with two months ago, we were the whole time we were saying probably 3 or 4, because we thought the economy a little better. Now we're getting more into that range, and we still think there's going to be cuts. I'll be very clear. I know what Chairman Powell said. Well, you know, cares what I care about. We care about is the reaction to the market. Had a big rally on Wednesday. Had a good follow through on Thursday. Overall, small and mid obviously led those rallies. That's kind of what I wanted to see and hear. But at the same time, you know, gold. Gold's that one area that, final comment here. I mean, we know this, right? Gold peaked in 2011, went nowhere for like 13 years, give or take, and it went up for like 11 years. These things, history doesn't repeat, but often rhymes. Now gold's obviously starting to break out. I love to see an asset that doesn't go anywhere for a long time is starting to move, is starting to go higher, and gold is obviously one of them. So yeah, we have a little bit of gold in our models. Now we get to the granular level of, the miners and the junior mine. No, we're just, you know, big gold ETF, putting that in there and just being happy there, but that's kind of how we see it.
Me too. And one thing I will add to what you said too is that I hold on to gold as a disaster hedge. I buy gold along the way as a belief that other people are going to buy gold for a disaster hedge. Does that make sense? Like, you know, when China, like, I don't believe in the de-dollarization of the globe,
right. But
when other central banks are buying more gold, I believe that they believe there's maybe a de-dollarization going on. And I try to get ahead of that trade. You mentioned Jerome Powell. I made a point today, yesterday on Fox, and I think this is interesting to me, is that I don't think markets necessarily just are in love with low rates. I think what they're in love with is rates that they think are lower than the actual macroeconomic condition dictates they should be. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense to you? And do you like that thesis?
No, I've never thought of it like that, but I think it does. I mean, you know, that's... Well, we love cheap money, right? We know that. I mean, that's kind of one of those, kind of true. You know, but again, like talking about rates and cuts and the Fed, I mean, we know the Fed hiked, you know, what, 10 times very aggressively. And clearly, why were they hiking in 22? Well, because of the, you know, the terrible war, the historical jumps in inflation. They were hawkish back then because of those reasons. Now they're a little more hawkish than they were this time 2 months ago. But why are they doing it now? Because the economy is strengthening. I mean, that's kind of the rationale that we see. You know, the consumer continues to be strong. We're still seeing jobs growth. You look at, everybody likes to talk about debt, and I get it. Like, there's a lot of debt that's out there, but if you look at debt relative to GDP from consumer debt or business debt, it's much lower than it was a couple of years ago. If you look at credit card debt, yeah, it's $1 trillion, but look at credit card debt as a percent of disposable income, which helps finance and pay for a lot of that credit card debt. It is the lowest level it's been in several years, lower than pre-pandemic. So there's two sides to every story. These are the sides we've been talking about when we crunch these numbers. Now, one final thing on that, you mentioned Bitcoin and crypto. I'm somewhat limited to what I can say there, but so we don't really have any positions in them, but Carson Group was one of the very first RIAs that approved some of these Bitcoin ETFs, right? Believe me, I know, because I'm in this industry. There's a lot of places looking at us, let's just wait, let's see. We'd rather let our financial advisors make the decision what's best for them and for their clients. So we have approved some of those Bitcoin ETFs, but we've not added them to our models quite yet. But I could see that potentially, you know, one of these days we might strongly consider it, but as of now, we haven't.
All right, so I'm going to say what I was going to say, and at the end of it, I was going to ask you about Bitcoin, but I'm going to say what I'm going to say, and I'm going to ask you about something else.
There we go.
Because you just kind of answered the question. I own gold. I've owned it since the end of 2022, right? So November of 2022, I said it was my trade for 2023. Worked out okay on a risk-adjusted basis, right? Yeah. Which is the way I like to look at things. And I'm staying in it. And the reason is, I hear a lot of people say what Jimmy says, and he's spot on correct. If everything goes to shit, the Fed's going to cut rates aggressively, and that should support gold. But gold is rallying right now with interest rates. The volatility in interest rates over the last, say, four sessions is dropping off a cliff. We've seen rates fall three of the last four sessions,
yeah,
but in trickles, 1 basis point, 2 basis points. I think, and gold spiked higher, did a gap higher in the future side of things, mm-hmm, and closed at a new record high, not a new all-time high.
Right, had a nasty reversal a while back, yeah.
Yeah. I believe we're reflating, and I want you to tell me if I'm nuts or if you agree. I believe we're reflating. So gold is an asset. Stocks are assets. Real estate is an asset. Bitcoin can be an asset.
Yeah.
And all of these things are going up together because people forget about asset inflation. And unless there's a Fed aggressively trying to control inflation, which they just said, Jimmy just mentioned it, right? Mm-hmm. They bumped up their GDP forecast. They bumped up their core PCE forecast. They lowered their unemployment rate forecast. And they said, but it's still going to be appropriate to cut rates. So that's why I think gold is going up right now, yet it's still a disaster hedge. Mm-hmm. Which is kind of amazing. Now, in a reflation, and here comes the question, in a reflating narrative, if you do an equity sector back test, one of the best performers sector-wise is energy. How do you feel about energy going forward in the coming months?
Yeah, so energy stocks in general obviously are flirting with breaking out. I mean, the thing we are neutral energy. We're overweight energy a good chunk of the last 2 years. Well, I actually worked, and earlier this year we went to a little more neutral energy. But what I do like about energy is, look at XLE, okay? I mean, XLE is like lower than it was in 2008. Mm-hmm. That's probably about the only, I don't know off the top of my head, that may be about the only sector that's maybe utilities after what they've been through. But nonetheless, it's pretty darn rare to be lower than you were in 2008 at this point. So that is encouraging. And the reflation, you know, this is interesting. I love the way you put that. Reflation, to me, when I hear that, it means the economy's getting going again. It doesn't mean inflation has to start roaring its ugly head, so to speak. I mean, the thing people love to complain about is inflation. I get it. You look at the surveys, I mean, inflation is like the worst thing possible if you ask a consumer, because I'm at the store and things cost more. We get all that, but then again, like, you know, would we really be having between 4 to 5% wage growth if we didn't have a little higher inflation right now? Probably not. One of the big differences between now and what are the four most dangerous words, right? This time is different. Sir John Templeton, in the 1970s we had about 9% wage growth. Well, that's all you told somebody, they might say, "Ooh, that sounds pretty good." No, because we had massive inflation that just ate into it. We also had 1% annualized productivity in the 1970s. 70s. I don't know if you guys are Alice Cooper fans. I saw a funny meme of Alice Cooper on Twitter a while back, and he's clearly had one too many beverages, much younger looking Alice Cooper. And it said something like the 1970s. If you remember him, you weren't there. So the 70s had really low productivity for a lot of reasons. We'll get into it. You fast forward to what we're seeing now, right? Let's go to the mid-90s. We had productivity growing about 3 to 4%. You had wage growth around 5%. You had inflation around 3%. Does that sound familiar? Yes, we're average annualizing 3.7% annualized productivity the last three quarters. Okay, that's like the best we've seen since, again, the mid-90s. To us, the door is open to have pay higher wages, to have higher wages, but not to have the nastiness of higher inflation along with it, because productivity is stronger. And why is productivity stronger? I don't really think it's about AI yet. It's coming. It's coming, right? It's because you had 8 million people get new jobs the last 2 years that aren't leaving. Look at the JOLTS report, right? The quits and layoffs. People aren't quitting their jobs. And I'm a perfect example. 2022, I quit my job, got a new job across the street, make a little more money, have a little more fun. Thank God I did. And a lot of people did that. But now people are staying where they are because there's not as many jobs go across the street to get that big jump in pay. Believe me, it's there. And if you can get it, amen, power to you. But it's not as easy as it was 2 years ago. So now people are getting a lot more productive in their jobs, along with just, you know, last comment. So I live in Cincinnati, Ohio, right up in other side of Columbus, Ohio. Intel is building like one of the largest chip facilities in the country. Here's an F word for you again. Fiscal policy doesn't have to be a bad thing. The CHIPS Act, the Inflation Reduction Act, which was never about reducing inflation. It was all about chips and EVs. A lot of these things that we're building are coming, right? A lot of high paying jobs are coming from what these incredible factories, because you know what? We didn't like when China was on shutdown, and we weren't. We want our chips. We want our chips. We're going to bring them back. We are a divided country. We get it. One of the few places we agree on is being tough on China. So I don't know who's the next person in the White House is going to be. I don't think it matters so much, because I think being tough on China and bringing a lot of these things back are good. And that, again, can probably help productivity.
So can I jump in here? Because I have a question.
Yeah, I'll shut up for a minute. Go ahead. Yeah.
No. I don't I don't want to be the guy who's about to throw a wet blanket on everything, but I'm going to be the guy, because you mentioned a lot of stuff and a very, very positive stuff. And again, I like Bobby. I like to come to you because sometimes I trend to the everything is, you know, burning timbers falling from the ceiling. Everything sucks. But to say a lot of the things you said and not mention the fact that we are accumulating debt, you said fiscal policy and the CHIPS Act, whatever. I don't like it as a libertarian, but it still could succeed. It still could succeed greatly. Just that, you know, as a general rule of those things, I don't think corporatism is a great way to go. That being said, so we're accumulating debt at the pace of a drunken sailor, you know, who's got some sort of brain injury. And the question becomes, how does that fit with your, it sounded like you said soft landing, no landing, actual expansion. Tell me how it fits in together.
Yeah, that is a great question. And I get to present all around the country. And believe me, the government debt is a popular, what are we up to, $34 trillion? I mean, I don't even know. I mean,
34.5. Yeah.
Whatever. Yeah, I mean, hey, just blink and it might be a little higher. So here's the honest truth. You know, we've had a lot of debt in a long time in our country. I hate to be the guy to say it doesn't matter, but I mean, it hasn't mattered yet, okay? And I know maybe we'll pay the piper someday. And I get it, interest rates are higher, so the debt, what the government's paying on the debt is more than they were paying before. Totally understand all those things. But, you know, at the end of the day, we do have the cleanest shirt and the dirty laundry, right? The U.S. dollar. I mean, in March of 2020, what happened? U.S. dollar is about the only thing that went higher. Gold was hit. Bonds were hit. Even stocks were killed. We know that. Dollar is higher. The first 10 months of 22, what happened? Everything was down pretty much, except for energy and except for the U.S. dollar. So as long as we have the world's reserve currency, guys, I hate to just put a big eraser on this and say just ignore it, because I'm not saying that necessarily. But what I am saying is maybe you can play by a different set of rules. To us, what we're watching a lot closer is overall household debt, right? Household debt is like, what, $21 trillion overall. But, you know, equity is, I think, $175 trillion. That's actually, equity has gone up substantially higher than overall debt on the household level. Then you look at businesses, right? I mean, look at business equity to debt. And this is free data right on the Fed, St. Louis Fed. You can get this stuff. That has been improving drastically as well. So to us, the balance sheets of consumers and corporations in the United States are actually a lot better than they've been the last couple of years. And in the consumer case, you could argue the balance sheets are about the best they've been in a couple of decades. That makes people angry when I say that. But again, when you look at the actual data, you can make that argument. So the debt of the country matters, but I don't know if it matters that much. Right now, I just pulled my ear. Maybe it means I'm lying. I don't know, but I'm not sure. I just think, you know, the household debt matters more.
That's okay, Bobby.
Yeah.
No, it's funny you say that because, you know, as a longer term, like as again, I trade in about a month at a time, mm-hmm. right? That doesn't matter to me. You know, I might look at a headline and say that's going to affect the trade I'm in right now.
Yeah.
But I would think that people who are in their 30s, maybe 40s, but for sure 20s should be somewhat concerned about it. But I don't know how they prep for that now, man. That's like Thomas Sowell always said that, you know, there's no solutions. There's only trade-offs. And I keep wondering what the trade-off for that debt is going to be. But I have a business question for you. And this actually came up within my family. I had a cousin call me up and say, you know, my guy, he'd been doing so good for me all these years. And then during the pandemic, he lost so much money. And, you know, I tore him a new asshole. And now he's not making me any of that money back. And I'm going, okay, so you tore him a new asshole. What are you in right now? Just bonds.
Right.
Well, you're in it because you tore him a new asshole.
Yeah.
That's why you're in bonds right now.
You clipped his wings. Yes. Right.
And so I started to explain to him the function of bonds. Like, you're not going to make money mark to market on bonds, but you're guaranteed the money at the coupon payout.
Eventually.
Mm-hmm. Do you have a hard time explaining that to people, or do your RIAs have a hard time explaining that to people that, look, when you're in bonds, you need to have sort of a duration view of those bonds?
Yeah, so I'm not a portfolio manager, more right. market strategist, right. so I don't go into that. But I know our PMs absolutely point that out time and time again. But but the bigger picture, what you just pointed out, is so true, unfortunately, right? October 22, everybody was bearish, everything was going to end, the end of the world was near, and people said, get me in gold, get me in cash, get me in bonds, get me out of the stock market, and then that happened. I mean, that unfortunately has happened so many times. You know, I don't have an easy answer here other than, you know, that's unfortunate that they did that, but we've seen that throughout time. I mean, we're you know, at the end of the day, we're cavemen, right? We get in the cave and be safe. And if things are scary, then let's just do what we have to do to protect ourselves. And we our brains are great things, but they make the worst possible decision at the absolute worst possible time. Historically, that's what we've seen time and time again. I mean, listen, we've been bullish. And I mean, October 27th, when we moved into correction, right? I mean, you can go look at the tweets we were saying. I mean, we were bullish, but even then, like, everyone over the weekend was about an October crash, a crash. I mean, I wasn't scared, so to speak, but I was like, ooh, this is getting a little, you know, most years have a correction. We drew up just 5 months in a row. Now we pulled back 10%. It's fairly normal. Fortunately, we had the 14% rally in the S&P, 24% in small caps those last 2 months, so things came back. But yeah, it's even if you feel a certain way, everybody else is telling you one thing, it can weigh on you, and that's unfortunate for a lot of investors that historically do that time and time again.
So one thing that Ryan just said that I'd like to reiterate, because I was going to say before, we are psychologically hardwired to be awful traders and awful investors, because I always go back to George Costanza, because he hit it right in the head. It was literally the most brilliant. Do you guys know what I'm referring to when he was explaining his trading style?
Yeah,
he said, when every possible fiber in my body and my brain says to sell it, I buy it. And the guy there looking at it like, really? Yeah, really. And it works. And by the way, I learned most about trading and investing on that day and that episode than I have anything else. I want to branch it to something else. Now, this is just, I want you to analyze something, because it's something that's kept me up all night. Yesterday, we interviewed on our other podcast, Jared Dillian, who wrote a book called No Worries. And he's come up and back tested what he calls the awesome portfolio. And it's five ETFs. Yeah, it's 20% gold. There's a book. 20% gold, 20% real estate, 20% bonds, 20% cash. What am I missing, Bobby?
Stocks, Brian.
The value? 20% stocks. Yeah. So 20% stocks, 20% real estate, 20% bonds, 20% cash. Yeah. Okay. But anyway, he says I have it on a picture here. But his point is that since 1970, and I'll have exactly what it is in a second, since 1970, this portfolio of 20% for five different things has made an average of 8.1% per year, less than that stock's average of 8.5% a year. However, biggest drawdown. However, its biggest drawdown was 12%. When you hear a statistic like that, is that going to make you go and look into it? Is it interesting to you?
Well, it's definitely interesting. No question about it. You know, at the same, does he reallocate every so often? The rebalance, I guess, better word. Rebalance every so often, or do you know that? Or
No, of course he has to.
He has to.
Yeah, so he starts.
It's got to be a yearly rebalance, I bet.
Yeah, I mean, you know, so that it makes sense. I mean, you know, I don't know. I mean, it my head's thinking a couple different things here, but it's
are you gonna cuss? You know,
no, I'm not gonna cuss. No, I'm trying to think of a word to say.
Do you drink, Ryan?
Everyone, I haven't today. Does it seem like it? Yeah, once in a while I will. I will once in a while.
In a while? Like at 7 o'clock every night or no?
No. Usually I'm at a basketball practice by then. Maybe every 3 weeks or so, go with some friends and do something.
Do you coach basketball?
Yeah, my boys. I've got two boys, a 13-year-old and 11-year-old. I don't know. I guess this is spring basketball now, so I'm not really coaching their teams now. But I did help coach. I mean, usually I'm the assistant. I travel a lot for work, so I'll usually be the assistant coach. That way, if you're not there, it's not that big a deal. But
right.
Yeah,
I coached for 25 years, and there is some talk that I might be getting into it because my niece took a big head coaching job at one of the big high schools around here. And she has been talking to me a little bit about being on her bench, which I think would be fun. But I coached a long time.
Can I make a guess then? Okay, so if you coached for 25 years, I'm going to say your over-under was you had 37 technicals, 1.5 a year. 37 technicals.
Bobby,
I know you had a few.
Bobby, guess with how hot I am, guess how many technicals I've had, Bobby?
I would say two.
Okay. You know how many technicals I've had, Ryan, and how many? Well,
you're going to tell me none, aren't you?
I'm going to tell you none, but I have been kicked out of several games. The reason I've had none, because for 10 of those years, one of my good friends and my assistant coach was a guy named John Simios, and he is a hot-headed Greek, and he would get all the technicals. And when he'd get a technical, I'd get kicked out of the game being the head coach. So I've been kicked out of like 5 games, but I've never gotten a technical.
Ryan, ask him how many times he's been punched in the face.
Well, that's
20. That's going to be around 37.
There's that 20,
because that involves booze. Usually, and basketball doesn't involve booze. Basketball is a tactical game. What are we talking about here? Are we talking about finances again, Bobby?
I don't know. Yeah.
No, look, this to me is an amazing subject, an amazing angle, because again, this is part of the reason I go to Ryan. When things go bad, right, people tend to do – there was a documentary years ago, and I don't remember what it was called. It was on Nova or something, where people were asked – if they could get $100 now or $115 a year from now, everybody, like 90% of them took the $100 now. Right. But if it was like $100 now or $101 in 2 days, they took the $101 in 2 days. So it was this weird sort of, this human economics is what I like to call it, where we sit there and we say, there's got to be a way to convince people. And it's one of the reasons we do this show, Ryan. It's not the only reason. The main reason is because both of us got kicked off regular media for the most part, but
for being big mouths.
Yeah. We walked voluntarily.
I was on CNBC this morning. You said I'm going to get blackballed after coming on this show.
No,
don't tell him you came on this show.
Yeah. Don't tell him you came on this show. Right.
No, you'll be fine. I'll say this off the air. The fact of the matter is that people look at this and they look at their balances, right? Mm-hmm. And they say, that's how rich I am now, right? And because stocks do undulate but go up, right? It's the kind of thing like when you're looking at it, you show anyone a chart and go, look, the S&P went from here to here, but it did this along the way, so calm the fuck down. Mm-hmm. You know, that's got to drive your PMs crazy sometimes where they're like, look, you're yelling at me. And in a few months, you're going to be yelling at me again. It is a thankless business what those guys do.
No, it is.
I really do think those guys need to be sort of applauded for when they're able to stick by that stuff.
No, I mean, PMs or just financial advisors. If I were
advisor
every day, and yes, they're getting yelled at one time. And then when things come back and make a good call, it's not like they're calling you, congratulating you, patting you on the back, so to speak. But, you know, Jim, back to your 2020, adds up to 100 or so. What I like about that, I guess, is if that helps people stay in, or I'm not a big fan of ESG necessarily or whatever it is. But what I like about it is if you really believe in it, you know, when the times are tough, that's when you're not just going to blindly get out of a strategy, right? If you really believe in it, and if having that balance of a portfolio helps keep people in, I mean, hey, that's as someone who's trying to help people reach their long-term investment goals, that's I'm all for it. Now, here's one quick little story, little anecdote, whatever you call it. Pavlov and Pavlov's dogs, right? There was a terrible flood about 100 years ago. Remember Pavlov? He rings the bell, the dogs slobber. Because I mean, it was time to eat. That's Pavlov and Pavlov's dogs. There was a terrible flood in Leningrad. A lot of the dogs unfortunately passed away. It's about 100 years ago. Then, because they were in these cages. Sad story. But then on the other side of it, a couple dogs did live. He rang the bell after that terrible flood and terrible event. You know what happened, guys? This is like 2 or 3 days later. It wasn't that many days later. The dogs did not slobber. He deducted, I think rightfully so, 100 years ago, that in times of extreme stress, in times of extreme fear, when everything around you is falling apart, our brains short fuse, our brains don't work, our brains make the worst possible decision, and we maybe forget things as well that we should have, that were right in the moment, right? And that is what happens in markets. I mean, markets pull back, they have bear markets. What do we care about? Our family and our friends and our cash, or our religion, our investments. I mean, those are things we care about the most, right? So we make these bad decisions in times of stress, and that's just unfortunately how most people are wired. So this is where I always spend it. That's why you need a financial advisor, because we're financial advisors. But nonetheless, you need to have something in there that helps you going to help yourself when those bad times come.
That makes a lot of sense to me, Bobby.
What's your favorite tool to use for your analysis? Is it Bloomberg? Is it Reuters? Is it just everything you get your hands on? Is it BizTalk? What's your favorite tool?
Good question there. So I use Y charts a lot. I have FactSet. I'm always using St. Louis Fed. I mean, they got tons of stuff. It's free, right? Price is right there. So I'm stock charts, Y charts, FactSet, and the St. Louis Fed, I'd say are the ones that I use like every single day. Yeah.
And in terms, when you put out things, something like, 3 to 6 months from now, the S&P was up X amount. Are you talking total return, or are you talking price to price?
Yeah. Normally I would specify, but 90% of the time it's price, just pure price. Not so much total return. And I obviously use Excel to create, go on my Twitter, anything you've ever seen me create or post, a chart, a table. I mean, that's Excel. I don't use Python. I'm kind of old school. I mean, I've always used Excel. I got good enough at it to be dangerous, made a career out of it. So I just use Excel for a lot of the stuff that I create. Like if you said, what's the one thing you couldn't live without to do your job? I would say Excel. If you took Excel away from me, I don't know what I'd do all day. You know, I mean, I need that one to create. Now, of course, you need the data and put it in there and crunch the numbers. And I just love, like, I always had this analytical mind, and then started using social media, specifically Twitter. It's called Twitter back then in 2009. I think like February 2009. What I found people liked was, hey, if this happened the last 10 times, this happened next. I discovered that was popular on social media many years ago, and now I've obviously made a career of it. And literally yesterday, I did a tweet on April. April's usually strong, blah, blah, blah. The stats are there. And then CNBC literally took it, put my picture on it, and shared it on closing bell. Like, how cool is that, that social media is that much of a impact, along with the data that I do, and hopefully the trust people have in what I've done over the years, that they just throw me on TV. I didn't know I was there. Someone took a picture of it and shared it to me. I was 3 o'clock yesterday afternoon. Like, oh, that's pretty cool.
I love that. That's one of my favorite things, to be mentioned on a show that I'm not on. Yeah. I think that's so exactly. Cool. And again, I need a little bit of stroking sometimes, and I really like that a lot. Something just dawned on me that I'd like to bring up. So my thesis, which involves something breaking throughout this year, and I think I'm thinking a banking crisis that involves commercial real estate. In your thesis that things are more fine than some of the doomsayers like me, stay there. Both of them kind of lead to the same place, because I'm saying that if the Fed comes back in and burning timbers are falling from the ceiling and they start easing quickly and they maybe restart QE, stuff's going to rise. Stuff's going to rally. And stocks are part of that thing, too. And you're saying everything's fine. We're in expansion. I know I'm paraphrasing it a little bit, but stocks are rallying that, too. So are we saying that either way, like what could be? What are we missing that could be the sock to the nards and stocks? Which, by the way, I'm trying to bring back the word nards. I try to mention it on each of the show. I want to change the name of our other podcast to Shot to the Nards, but Bobby has not approved it yet, and he is the boss.
Not agreed to it.
What is the catalyst could really give us that shot?
So a couple thoughts here, one I've kicked around. I mean, a year ago when we were pretty optimistic and bullish, everybody hated it. I mean, people absolutely hated being optimistic. I mean, I remember getting like literally laughed at by like an anchor on TV for talking about why the financial crisis, the regional bank crisis wasn't that big of a deal. It was only a couple bad apples. Now, I know the Fed came in and backstopped things, but you have to factor that into your analysis. But now I look around and it feels like everybody's bullish. I mean, literally bears who were like on my stream all the time last year or most of last year, like calling me out for being optimistic. How it's not a bull market, it's a bear market, blah, blah. Fill in the blank. They're all agreeing with me. So I'm looking around thinking, oh boy, this is that worries me a little bit, Jimmy, that everybody feels like they're all of a sudden a bull when they sure weren't, last year. But I think I'm going to bring it back to the Fed a little bit. I mean, the Fed has said what they've said, that listen, they're not going to, they're optimistic. What did the Fed just say last week, right? We had 6 good months of inflation data. Now 2, I'm not going to say bad months, but 2 iffy months of inflation data. We're not worried about it. Maybe inflation comes back a little bit. That's not our base case. Let me be clear. Maybe that does. And then the Fed becomes a little more hawkish. And you get, why is the Fed becoming more hawkish? Is it because we're about inflation or because they think the economy's better? Those are the two things there to us. So those are the ones that we would have said. Honestly, goodness, if we'd done this 6 months ago, I probably would have said an energy shock. That could be the, I mean, look at energy stocks, right? I mean, maybe there's an energy shock coming. But all of a sudden, the United States is pumping, what is it, 13.2 million barrels of oil a day? You know, I mean, the terrible war that took place in the Middle East, I mean, oil spiked for like a day or two, you know, and then it came right back down because the U.S. can pump a lot more oil than we ever could have. So I'm not, you know, again, this time is different, foremost dangerous words, but it is because we are now the largest producer of oil out of anybody, which is different. So maybe we can control the energy prices a little bit more than we could have in the 1970s with an oil embargo, that period of higher inflation, a lower productivity and massively higher wages, but wasn't good because inflation was also high with it. We were pumping less than a million barrels a day back then, like 500,000, I think. Not many, right? Now it's over 13 million. So it's a big, big difference.
Bobby, I want you to answer that question too about what the risk is, but I would like to add something, just a quick question for clarity. You mentioned productivity in the 90s and you mentioned productivity now. Basically, what you're talking about is the internet in the 90s and potentially somewhat AI now seeping into white collar, making people's jobs easier and more productive. Is that, you think, what you're talking about or no?
Well, in a way, but at the same time, we've seen productivity the last three quarters really, really strong, like annualized 3.7%. And again, the productivity is, you know, how much work do you do to get the output? That's the simple. Right. I mean, that's what it is, right?
So, what we're seeing now is it could be AI,
AI could be the cherry on top that really continues the path. So it's like we've got better productivity now because, again, like I talk about, 8 million people have jobs, they're not leaving, they're not quitting. They're more productive now. Okay, that's when people are quitting jobs left and right, going across street, making 10% more. Hey, that's great. Making more money. But you know what? Productivity is not going to be very strong because you're always training, retraining, training, retraining. So we're kind of past that. But yes, the AI, and who knows how big it's going to be. It's probably going to be pretty big. I think most of us agree there. We don't know how big, but that could absolutely be the thing to keep the higher productivity that we expect to see. I mean, we saw higher productivity from 1995 to almost 2004. Now, I get it. There was a terrible three-year bear market in the middle there. So I remember that. But still, the mid to late 90s, the first part of that higher productivity was obviously, I mean, with 94, what happened, right? The Fed hiked rates a lot, upset the apple cart. Orange County went under. Bonds had one of their worst years ever. Stocks didn't do that well in 94. And then the market sniffed out cuts in 95. You had the higher productivity. You had the internet on the horizon. Yeah, it's not the same as now, but it's not that far off at the same time if you replace some of those words with certain other things.
Bobby?
Yeah, a couple of things. I want people to not rely so much on our crude oil production as something to lean, to fall back on. And the reason I say that is because we're producing more crude oil than we ever have. I wrote a piece for the CME group that they posted a little while ago. It's best case scenario, 18 months. Your average is about 2.5 to 3 years before you actually get production out of shale wells from exploration to lease and so on. So the production we're getting right now is from about 3 years ago. And the exploration and the CapEx has fallen off a cliff. It's starting to pick up again. And then the second part to that is the bulk of the production from shale wells, which is the bulk of the marginal production we get in crude oil now, comes at the beginning of the life of that well, which is not the case with traditional wells. So as long as the marginal production is shale, it's going to drop off quicker than it grew. So I really want things to change in terms of exploration in order to keep that going, because clearly there's been a hugely positive effect to the economy. And I don't mind the idea that inflation might peak its head because the Fed's not fighting it. So you take Ryan's point about productivity. Productivity is annualized at 3.7%. That's fantastic, because that means the inflation that will push asset prices higher. Again, that means stocks. Right. And that means people's houses, real estate, so they feel richer, will not get depressed by a Fed hiking rates if we get a productivity miracle. The productivity miracle was the only thing that could save us, to Ryan's point. And I think you were one of the people I saw tweet that, Ryan. And it's starting to look that way. So go ahead.
But I always argue that, you know, in 19, call it 85. Everyone gives Paul Volcker all this credit for slaying the inflation dragon, and he deserves some credit too.
Yeah.
But also, we were at the cusp of the single most disinflationary / deflationary piece of technology that's ever existed in the internet, right? So that, I mean, there's a lot of things that came into to, you know, together to cause that thing. Are we in a similar situation now? Do you give Jerome Powell credit for what's happened here?
Oh, I wouldn't give him too much credit. See, what grade do you give them? I mean, he was.
Thank you, David. Yeah, thank you,
I mean, he was, you know, Jerome Powell was, you know, Mr. Transitory, and
yeah, it
wasn't
transitory. Screwed that up. There's no question.
Yeah, I mean, so yeah, it's hard to give him a ton of credit, in my opinion. Good. I mean, you know, I give the true all-star was the U.S. consumer and the backdrop and the tailwind of this economy that so many people doubted. I made this joke before, but in December of 22, I tried to buy Taylor Swift tickets, and I did get them, but they cost a ton of money, obviously. I mean, the Ticketmaster shut down for a day because everybody in America is trying to buy tickets. I'm like, how is this recession? Everybody promises me is coming next year when everyone's spending thousands of dollars on these Taylor Swift tickets. That's a kind of a joke, and I know it's anecdotal, and I've got hard data we can talk about, but like, that was like, I don't know about that. And sure enough, that's where we are. And was that because of Jerome Powell? Maybe not. Now, you mentioned one quick one on Volcker, obviously the tallest Fed chairperson ever. Volcker,
6'8" or something,
6'7" 6'8", yeah, who knows. Yeah. But smoking that cigar, the cool thing about him, I think he has the greatest handoff in history. What I mean by that, the market had this huge rally, as we know, for 5 years, from 82 lows 87. August of 87 is when he said, I'm out. You take over. And then, of course, what happened, you know, Greenspan took over 2 months later or 3 months later, whatever that math is. Boom, there's the crash and then some trouble. So that was a pretty darn good job of him getting out near the peak and saying, you take over. Because he probably knew, you know, the market's up 500% in 5 years, 40% for the year in August. He said, I'm out. You go deal with this. This is probably going to be a headache. And sure enough, boom, it was.
I don't have any more questions, but I wanted to say that Ryan Detrick, you have been the earliest and the most correct in this, not just this last move a lot of the time, but
hold
this last
Tom move Lee too, not taking anything away with Ryan, but Tom Lee takes a lot of punches as well. Yeah. He's been a bull when others were bears as well. So I put my Mount Rushmore Ryan up there for talking me off the cliff a bunch of times too. Another quick question. And I do have one more. Yeah. I will always contend that the first five albums of Taylor Swift were absolutely brilliant. The lack of production, the country to it. But now lately, I think it's just too overproduced and I've kind of pulled away. I spent 15 years arguing with my music guys. You know, we're music guys. Like, they're like, oh, Taylor Swift, she's for 12-year-old girls. Bullshit. Taylor Swift has this rare talent of thinking an emotion and conveying it to you through her words and her music, like Neil Young, like Bob Dylan. Now, you said about Taylor Swift tickets. Are you a fan yourself, or are you willing to admit you're a fan yourself?
Oh, no. No. I would say I'm not a fan. No offense. It was for my daughter. I mean, my daughter's 16. She's
Are you a fan?
I'm a huge fan. I'm sorry. I'm not embarrassed by it. I am an out-of-the-closet Swifty. And I will say this, okay? She's probably a terrible girlfriend, but she's a pretty impressive artist.
Yes. And did your daughter love the show?
Oh yeah, I mean, she went last summer, and she's apparently going this November. She comes to Indianapolis, so close. If anybody's got some Taylor Swift tickets, want to send them my way for the Indianapolis show, I'll gladly take them because we're by. You know, just last week she saw Olivia Rodrigo, which is like really pop. Those were $600 a pop to go to Columbus, Ohio, at a huge facility where the 25,000 seats where the Blue Jackets play, which is the NHL team. I mean, it's just amazing, you know, what people are paying to do these things. And I don't know, it doesn't sound like a recession to me when I hear these things.
My daughter.
We're going to have to do an entire show, Jimmy, on the influencer effect to the economy. Because those are the people spending that money. Go ahead.
There's no question. My daughters, I think, each spent $1,000 on tickets to Taylor Swift. And then were offered $2,000 to give them up. And both said no. They went together. Again, this is not my money. This is their, you know, my daughters are adults. I'm not going to spend $1,000 for them to go to a Taylor Swift concert. But I think we covered pretty much everything we want to. Bobby, you got nothing else, right?
No, I just again wanted to compliment you, dude. Ryan, good. Seriously, yeah, you were correct. Ryan, you were early.
Yeah, so thanks, Ryan. And tell them where you can find on Twitter real quick.
Where can you find Mr. Brightside?
Yeah, at Ryan Detrick. And then our blog, that's Twitter, of course, X, whatever you want to call it. And then carsongroup.com/research. I do a lot of our team blogs on there as well. Then my podcast is called Facts Versus Feelings. Or type my name in or if you favorite podcast, weekly podcast, talk about all the stuff we just talked about. Do it with Sonu Varghese, a really smart guy on our team. We have a lot of fun doing that. So those are some places you can follow me if you're not already. I got a face for radio and I'm always all over the place. So just keep
up. You look good. I was thinking that too. You've lost a little weight. I think you look excellent, by the way.
I don't know. But thanks for lying to me. I don't know.
Thanks to you guys who are watching. Thanks to Tradier for sponsoring us. Remember, Bobby and I fully believe that this type of media is the only thing that's going to make sense going forward. The mainstream media oftentimes have been poisoned by sponsors putting pressure on them to say things. We don't have any of that pressure. Tradier is the greatest. Tradier would never tell us what to say or not say. They literally want to know our honest opinions. But thank you guys for all tuning in, particularly the ones who said hi to us. Anissa, David, thank you guys a ton. Thank you for being on the for being with us in Tradier's The Trader's Edge.
All opinions expressed by Tradier Hub contributors are solely the contributors' opinions and do not reflect the opinions of Tradier nor its affiliates and or subsidiaries. You should not treat any opinion expressed by Hub contributors as a specific inducement to make a particular investment or to follow a particular strategy, but only as an expression of their opinion. The contributors' opinions are based on their own personal research, but neither Tradier nor its affiliates and or subsidiaries warrants its completeness or accuracy, and it should not be relied upon as such. Any trades or positions discussed or referred to by contributors may or may not be actual live trades or positions. Such information is not intended to be a financial or investment advice. Tradier Inc. is the parent company of Tradier Brokerage Inc. Tradier Brokerage Inc. and Tradier Inc. are separate entities with their own products and services. Securities products and services are offered through Tradier Brokerage Inc. Tradier Brokerage Inc. is an independent subsidiary of Tradier Inc., all rights reserved, member FINRA/SIPC.